Well, good morning. My name is Byron Johnson. I direct the Institute for Studies of Religion here at Baylor University. It's a pleasure to have you all here, and it's especially a treat to have a number of members of the Elshtain family with us. And I think it'd be appropriate for Earl to maybe quickly introduce the family members that are here with us.
Oh. My name is Errol Elshtain. This is our son, Eric Elshtain.
How do you do?
His wife, Irene. Our youngest son and grandson, Bobby. Our oldest daughter, Sherry. Our youngest daughter, Jenny. Our youngest granddaughter, Christy.
Hi.
And our how will I reference you? Second.
Middle
daughter, Heidi.
Well,
we're delighted to be here. Thank you so much.
We're so delighted to have you here. And I thought maybe a good way just to start would be for some of you that don't know the story behind Jane Addams. You're going to be hearing a lot about her today. But you know, we started recruiting Jane in around 2010 to come to Baylor. And of course, everybody recruits Jane Addams, so there's a lot of competition, but not everybody flies to Nashville to visit with her in her home, which is what we did. And Jane was very interested in Baylor, and she said, you know, maybe we can work out a relationship that maybe I could come halftime. And so she did. She was halftime with Baylor the last 2 years of her life. We never knew how short that relationship was going to be. And but it was a wonderful 2 years with Jane, a dear friend. And Eric called me not too long after her death to talk about her collection of books. And the family has dedicated the books to Baylor. And so this afternoon we're going to have a private dedication service in Patton F. Hall of her beautiful book collection. So it's just a treat to have you all here to honor her in this way. And for, you know, I won't do a big commercial on ISR today. You can see us on the website, what we're up to. But I want to jump right into the program. And to kick us off, we have Susan Hanssen from the University of Dallas to share with us, who's a big fan of Jane Addams for many years, and she shared some neat stories last night. But she's going to come first and kick us off with a presentation. Susan.
So Jane Elshtain spent a good portion of her scholarly life interested in Jane Addams, who was the founder of Hull House, which was a settlement house for immigrants in the immigrant neighborhood in Chicago. And she wrote two books on Jane Addams, Jane Addams and the Dream of American Democracy. But also she did a collection, an anthology of Jane Addams's writings. Now, so my paper, which is very largely quotations from Jane Addams on Jane Addams, I'm a historian, so I just want to make sure that you're all sort of in the right place on the timeline. Jane Addams, right, sort of second half of the 20th century, looking back at Jane Addams in the first half of the 20th century. And I wanted to place Jane Addams just briefly before I begin in the history of American immigration. This might be appropriate, today being St. Patrick's Day, and the Irish, like the poor, being always with us as our greatest immigrant group of all time. Just to place Jane Addams and her work in the context of the history of American immigration, because she's very much a figure of Chicago. She's not very much a figure of Waco, Texas, right? So you have to put on your historical imagination to the beginning of the 20th century, and also to put on your historical imagination, right, in order to think about the great city of Chicago, which is actually my birthplace. My family is immigrant, the Irish and the Poles, what I call the fifth wave of American immigration and the sixth wave of American immigration meeting up in Chicago. South Side Irish from across the tracks marrying down into the Poles. it's a great American tradition, always marrying down into the next immigrant group, right? So because I wanted to make it clear, I myself am somewhat known as an Addams scholar, but that's the Addams family of Boston. That's the John Addams, John Quincy Addams, Charles Francis Addams, Henry Addams family, who've been in charge of American diplomacy for the entirety of our history, and kind of still are because they're involved in funding Raytheon and therefore drones. So, you know, in terms of American foreign policy, they're still there. So the Addams family, right, is known to everyone, but that's Addams with one D. And Jane Addams has no relation whatsoever to the Addams family. Her name is Addams with two D's, and she is Midwestern, born, raised, and working her entire life. So just a quick overview of American immigrant history. I mean, maybe I know Southerners and Texans love genealogy, so this might be fun. You could sort of place yourself on the map of the history of immigration. Of course, the first three waves of immigration, European immigration to North America, came all from England, and came because of the English Civil Wars, because of the disruption in the English economy and social system. And political system due to the Protestant Reformation and transformations within within Great Britain because of that. And so we have initially the Puritans moving to New England, the Cavaliers moving to Virginia, to the south, and we have nonconformists moving to the mid-Atlantic states. So you have the Puritan parliamentarians who want to use the power of the parliament to impose Puritan congregationalism on the entire country. And then you have the Cavaliers, the High Church Anglicans, supporters of the king, who want to use the power of the king and his king-appointed bishops to impose High Church Episcopalianism on the entire country. And when they come to the United States, they would make very strange political bedfellows because they're opponents in the English Civil War. So they move to the opposite ends of the American colonies, right? You have the Puritan parliamentarians setting up in New England, in Massachusetts, and you've got the supporters of the king and the Anglican Church, the Cavaliers, moving to the southern states. And historians make a big deal about the different cultures that are brought over by the English parliamentarians and by the Puritan parliamentarians and the supporters of the king, the Cavaliers, in the south. In the mid-Atlantic states, New York, New Jersey, Delaware, you have the nonconformists who are kind of wild band of nonconformists, right, who refuse to conform to either the Puritan parliamentarian church or to the Episcopalian king-appointed and king-directed church. And so nonconformists come in lots of stripes. You've got Quakers, Shakers, Unitarians, Catholics, right, from sort of every Baptists, Methodists, anyone who is what they called anti-Erastian, anyone who opposes the power of the state, be it the parliament or the king, over the church, right? So church independence of all sorts come over to the mid-Atlantic states. So that's the 1600s. That's our smallest European immigration ever. So small, right, that people can track their genealogies back to the people on the Mayflower, and it's only 100 people, right? And so then, you know, you've got this sort of cachet for being, you know, a Mayflower American, right? In the 1600s, those are small groups. There are more Cavaliers and their indentured servants moving to the South than there are New England Puritans. There are a great deal more nonconformists moving to the mid-Atlantic states, to Pennsylvania, than there are Puritans and Cavaliers. So there's a kind of crescendo factor already in American immigration history where every wave of immigration gets bigger and bigger, right? Puritans small, Cavaliers bigger, nonconformists bigger. They tend to become bigger immigrations and poorer immigrations. This is sort of general crescendo, more people and poorer, right? The longer you wait in Europe, the worse your social situation becomes, and you come over even poorer, right? So the English of the 1600s is the first wave of, well, the first three waves, because they really are distinct waves of immigration to North America. Maybe I can just pause and say we should recognize the fact that more Europeans come to North America than ever went to Latin America. 700,000 Spaniards went to Latin America in the entire time of the Spanish Empire, 700,000. over 5 million Europeans came to North America in a 300-year period, in the same 300-year period. So in terms of Europeanization, North America is a largely Europeanized continent as opposed to Latin America. I think I'm telling you things that you already know, and yet I think it's good to bring it to the forefront of your mind so that we can sort of situate ourselves to understand who Jane Addams was, right, and why she was important on the grand scale of American history. Why Jane Addams thought that that her reputation and her work and her legacy was worth perpetuating on into the 21st century, when we're still dealing with the question of being an immigrant nation. So 1600s, the English. In the 1700s, after the English shut down the Scottish Parliament, destroyed the Scottish Parliament and absorbed it into the great mother of all parliaments, the Westminster Parliament in London, the Scots came over in even larger numbers. But the Scots couldn't go to the South, to New England, to the mid-Atlantic states, because the entire eastern seaboard was full up of the English. And in all honesty, the English saw the Scots as foreign barbarians, immigrants who didn't understand English common law and would be a danger to society. And so the Scots flowed across the eastern seaboard, across the Appalachians, and into the west, right, into Ohio and down the Appalachian Mountain Trail into Tennessee, Kentucky, Georgia, and onwards out towards Texas, where I suspect there still are a large number of them, until they all got scared up into Chicago by the Tennessee River Valley project in the 1930s. So that's actually another portion of my family that just sort of is part of the Scots-Irish migration that moved to Tennessee and then, oops, ended up in Chicago. Everyone ends up in Chicago in the end, right? That's the Chicago's the great melting pot of the West. So English, Puritans, Cavaliers, Nonconformists, and then Scots. That's 1, 2, 3, 4 immigration waves, right? And there's this tendency of the English to look at the Scots as foreigners, Scots Presbyterians, filling up the eastern seaboard and the land out west. Along with the Scots come a lot of Palatine Germans who are also fighting against the construction of a state German Lutheran church and wanting independent Lutheran churches as well. So you get a large contingent of Germans at the same time, Pietist Germans. Then, during the Napoleonic Wars, the British Empire shuts down the Irish Parliament. This is a habit that they have, right? Shutting down parliaments, absorbing the Irish Parliament into the great British Parliament at Westminster. And the Irish start coming over in large numbers in the 1800s. Again, a crescendo, right? The Scots are poorer than all three English migrations put together. The Irish of the 1800s are poorer than the Scots of the 1700s, are poorer than the English coming over in the 1600s, right? There's a crescendo of more of them and poorer, right? The Irish don't have enough money to move out west and get land of their own, not to mention the fact that they had been landless peasants for 200 years in Europe before they ever came over, because they weren't allowed to own their own land. Their land had been confiscated from them. They had already moved into the cities in England looking for work in London, Manchester, Liverpool. They were used to industrial labor. When they came here, they moved to the cities. And so the initial urbanization of America was Irish urbanization, right? So the eastern seaboard, right, the western lands, and then the cities, right, constructed by these waves of immigration. Now, when the Irish came, suddenly the English and the Scots realized that they had something in common, that they were all Protestant, whereas the Irish were Roman Catholic. And so they saw them, now they were the new and horrific immigrant wave, right? Before it had been the Scots, because, you know, the Scots were barbarians, the Scots didn't understand English common law. You weren't allowed to have Scots in the colonial militias. And George Washington did something very radical in allowing the Scots to be in the Continental Army. God bless him for doing it. But suddenly they could band together and say what it meant to be American is to be Protestant, and the Irish Roman Catholics aren't. Now, all of these waves of immigration had come over, nevertheless, fleeing the rise of the British modern nation state, the consolidation, the unification, and the construction of state power in Great Britain. But in some sense, they didn't see that commonality. It took a long time for them to sort of reflect historically and see the commonality that they had of where they were coming from and what they were fleeing, right? Because they could still smell and taste and see the differences among themselves here in America. But after 1870, the Franco-Prussian War, after 1870, when Germany suddenly appeared on the scene in Europe as a great land power, after 1870, when Germany, Italy, and Russia began following the same path that Great Britain had followed for three centuries of consolidating and unifying state power, after Germany, Italy, and Russia began the project of mechanizing their economies, turning over to an industrial model, shutting down all sorts of subsidiary groups, families, local associations, guilds, monasteries, universities, setting up state education, a state-run economy. As that process is moving forward in Italy, Germany, and Russia, and I say Germany mostly because Germany did it best and fastest, right? Germany managed to accomplish the construction of a unified state in 50 years, which it took Great Britain 300 years to do. It took them three centuries to do, right? But in 50 years, the Germans managed to pull it off. As Germany appears in Europe, right, as this growing power, all along of the fringes of Germany and the fringes of Russia and the fringes of Italy, you start to have the same kind of emigration to the United States that you had seen with all of the fringe groups that were disappointed by the rise of British state power, just as you had the English and the Irish and the Scots, the English, the Scots, and the Irish coming over in opposition to the rise of state power in Britain. You start to have Polish, Russian Jews, Croatians, Romanians, Hungarians, Sicilians, Neapolitans, the Piedmontese, the Bavarians, the Saxons, anyone who didn't want to sign on to the mega state project that was being built, right, in Europe at the time. And our immigration went from 5 million in three centuries, right, to 25 million in 10 years, 50 million in 20 years, right? There's an explosion of immigration between 1870, the Franco-Prussian War, and World War I, when we actually had to face Germany. So that immigration wave, of course, looked distinct, right? Looked like something we had never faced before. It was bigger, it was poorer, and it didn't even speak English. Right, so suddenly the Irish, I'm wearing my green here, right? Suddenly the Irish look extraordinarily American, right? So they get included in the group. It doesn't matter that they're Roman Catholic, at least they speak English of a sort, right? You wouldn't want them to be nursery maids because they'll teach your children a brogue, right? But you can have them in your home as domestic servants, right? Because at least they understand you, right? This new wave of immigration, the sixth wave of immigration, right, is perceived as something completely different, right? And it largely moves out west because we've had the explosion of the railroads, coal, oil, right? It's a Midwest phenomenon. At one point, Henry Adams, I don't want to get you confused between the Adamses, but at one point, Henry Adams says that this mass of people give the impression that the Rhine and the Danube had poured itself into the Mississippi. And he said that they're being forged by the factory system, and that presently the new American of the 20th century will appear, and that the new American will have no other characteristics, no other marks of its birth than the machine, right? The dynamo, this, you know, sort of the new American who will see itself as a worker, and nothing but a worker, right, will find it very difficult to naturalize and to Americanize and to join the local communities and the local churches and in some sense, the sprawling decentralized system that is characteristic of America up to that point. The danger that what we will get is an underclass of immigrants who will always see themselves as workers, as peons of the state, right, dependent on the state. That they will think of themselves not as a human being, but as a number, with a social security number and a zip code, and that's it. 23151-1923, living in 75062. That's it, right? And I can move my zip code and my social security number somewhere else as a worker, right? So Jane Bethke Elshtain, from the point of view of the end of the 20th century, is looking back to the beginning of the 20th century and identifying Jane Addams and Jane Addams' visionary response to the plight of the immigrant, right? That the plight of the immigrant is central to the American story, and that we need to learn as a nation how to deal with the stranger as neighbor, right? That it's crucial to our national culture. So with that as intro, I have a brief paper which is all Elshtain on Addams, right? But I hope that this will help to situate us a bit more. In her classic study, Jane Addams and the Dream of American Democracy, Jean Elshtain argued that while at her death, Jane Addams was America's best known and most widely hailed female public figure, the main reason for Addams's posthumous eclipse is that government-controlled and administered welfare programs of the 1930s supplanted the settlement house movement Addams had pioneered. Elshtain went on to suggest that it is a propitious moment at which to reconsider Addams's life and legacy because traditional government welfare programs have been challenged from the left and the right. According to Elshtain, the centerpiece of Jane Addams's legacy is that she never lost sight of the single unique person in her determination to ease the suffering of the many. Elshtain is explicit in her conclusion. She says, "I believe Jane Addams would have emerged as a critic of the post-war welfare of what the post-war welfare state became, with its mode of top-down social provision and its turning of would-be and should-be citizens into clients. She would have been appalled at impersonal techniques and the commodification of persons. She herself was always attentive to the delicate, fragile, indelible, and irreplaceable lineaments of this singular self. She would have considered modern society to have lost its bearings by looking past what Carol Wojtyła, John Paul II, called the irreducible quality of each and every unique human life." Jean Elshtain put great emphasis on Addams's anthropology, her view of the human person. Addams rejected the idea that the human is a mere stimulus response mechanism. Rather, human beings are beings who respond in complex and creative ways to changing situations. They can take their own emotions as something to be analyzed, formed, and channeled appropriately, and they can be touched by a profound yearning to be of service to others. Indeed, one of Jane Addams's favorite, most often quoted scripture passages was Psalm 42. "As the deer longs for running streams, so my soul longs for you, my God." The psalmist's frank yearning touched Addams deeply. Addams explicitly rejected Marxism and socialism as ideologies and doctrines and as methods for social change. She repudiated ideologies that tended to overlook the uniqueness of each human life and each life's journey. Addams herself was extraordinarily attentive to particularity, both in the people she dealt with and their social situation. Elshtain describes her as consistently providing what has been called, in Clifford Geertz's phrase, thick description, rich context, elaborately describing sights, sounds, smells, and other observations. Yet her habit of inhabiting reality and expressing its nature, which William James so much admired, her attentiveness to everyday life, the ordinary, and the common, never became, as it seemed to for Ralph Waldo Emerson, an idealization of the common, the familiar, the low, in and of itself. As G.K. Chesterton once pointed out, "It is a peculiarly modern mood to idealize the primitive, and it can be an elitist betrayal of the experience of the poor to idealize the communal life of the slums." In evading this idealization, Addams avoided co-opting the concrete living reality, the presence of her neighbors, into some social theory of necessary change or progress. Nevertheless, Addams was adamant, Elshtain points out, that the attainment of individual morality no longer suffices. One must come to grips with new realities and meet the demands of social morality. That emphasis on facing new realities echoes the encyclical letter of Pope Leo XIII, published the same decade as the launch of Hull House in the 1890s, Rerum Novarum, the new things, or on the condition of the working classes. It is no surprise, then, that Addams is co-founder of Hull House and longtime associate Ellen Gates Starr, eventually converted to Catholicism, once she felt that she had gauged that the Catholic Church embodied not only the liturgical beauty that her heart sought, but also the concern over social justice. One sees the same concern for beauty in Addams, who hung the walls of the Hull House nursery with classic Renaissance images of the Madonna and Child. Working alongside of Jane Addams and Ellen Starr in the 19th Ward, the murder capital of the world, the Little Italy neighborhood of Chicago, was Mother Frances Xavier Cabrini, who had hoped to go as a missionary to China, but had been directed instead by Leo XIII to go to the suffering European immigrants of the American cities. Jane Addams's Nobel Peace Prize in 1931 and Pius XI's beatification of Mother Cabrini in 1938 shone a bright light on the need for this turn towards social morality in response to the new conditions of modern, urban, industrial, global mass society. Both Jane Addams and Mother Cabrini, the patron saint of immigrants, devoted their life to the problem of the immigrant as neighbor. For both, naturalization and enculturation to their new homeland was an essential part of the welcome that they extended. Elshtain concludes that while initially public social provision emerged during the Progressive Era in a particular way that respected the structural features of the American political system, especially its decentralized federal system and the vital connection between vital local voluntary groups, but she feared that the vital connection between these vital local voluntary groups, groups like Hull House, families, churches, neighborhoods, and particular trade unions, got lost. While these groups often required government assistance to meet their stated goals, they often sorted through those deemed most worthy of public assistance from a position close to the ground. They aimed particularly to solve the problem of family desertion. They looked askance at systematic charity that replaced absent fathers with the state welfare system and favored family preservation, finding a way to hold families together through the intervention of an outside third party. What men did not do that troubled Addams most was support and stay with their families, even though she understood the indignities heaped on them in the world of work, half-work, and non-work, and the confusion, perplexity, and diminution they daily experienced. Addams would never have seen modern, global, state-directed mass welfare as the solution to the creation of a modern global mass movement of rootless strangers. Indeed, Elshtain suggests that Addams herself could discern the connection between state welfare programs in Roman antiquity with state-sanctioned child exposure. Elshtain hopes that reviving Jane Addams's reputation will give us pause regarding the metamorphosis of Addams-type social engagement into social administration. Whereas private, local, personally run charities can respond to the uniqueness of the person and personal needs, including spiritual needs, as Addams makes clear in her work on everything from playgrounds to prostitution, state welfare programs often continue forms of social assistance that destroy personal responsibility and local community year after year, decade after decade, in a form of blatant blindness. The activities of Hull House grew helter-skelter, responding not to an overall plan, but to the imperatives of the neighborhood, the ingenuity of the residents, and the stresses of a rapidly changing society. Some of that respect for old-fashioned American liberalism, both the liberty and liberality of actual Americans on the ground, is what Elshtain suggests is Jane Addams's lesson for our own day. Thank you.
Thank you, Susan. We had a lovely dinner last night with the panelists today and the Elshtain family, and it was just a fantastic discussion. I wish you could have all been there to hear it. A lot of laughter in the room, and our provost, Greg Jones, and I had a conversation early on, soon after he arrived here, and I was letting him know about Jane Addams, but I didn't know if he'd heard of Jane Addams. And he goes, yeah, Byron, I've known Jane for over 30 years and have had many interactions with Jane, and he shared some of those funny stories last night. And I thought it'd be great if our provost, Greg Jones, could kick us off with some comments on Jane. He may even share some funny stories with you. And let me just say what a godsend Greg Jones has been to Baylor. He came here in June and what a blessing he is to us. Greg, come share with us.
Thanks, Byron, and thanks, Susan, for a wonderful set of comments on Jane Addams and Jane Addams. As Byron mentioned, I had the privilege, I think it was actually my first published piece ever, was a review essay of two of Jane's books, Public Man and Private Woman and Women in War. And after it appeared, Jane contacted me because she'd been quite taken both by my appreciation, but also I'd raised some critical questions. I was in graduate school at the time. And, you know, when I first got a letter from Jane Addams, I thought, uh-oh, you know, I've been exposed, life is about to end. She then came to Duke to give a lecture. We struck up a friendship, and it deepened when she just observed casually to me that she wondered if she might be related to Dietrich Bonhoeffer's biographer. I was working on Bonhoeffer at the time. And she noted that her name, Bethke, B-E-T-H-K-E, was similar to Bethge, Eberhard Bethge, B-E-T-H-G-E. And she just wondered, and she said, Bonhoeffer's kind of a fascinating character, and I just happened to register that. And I took that to mean that she really knew a lot about Bonhoeffer. And so I invited her to come when I had started teaching at Loyola College in Baltimore to give a lecture on Bonhoeffer. And Jean, in her typical generous and charitable way, said, sure. And then she kept deferring, as the year went on giving me a title for the lecture. And I was puzzled by that. And then when she finally showed up, she said, you know, I really don't know much about Bonhoeffer, and I don't know why you invited me here. She was decidedly less cheerful than I'd ever seen her in an environment. She said she'd had to write the lecture on the plane from California to Baltimore. And when I saw that it was handwritten notes on legal pad, I panicked because I was still a junior faculty member and I thought they'd never again entrust me with money to bring a speaker who hadn't prepared. And then she stood up and gave an absolutely brilliant and insightful lecture into Bonhoeffer. As a theologian, as a Christian witness, as a vision of what a wise life would look like, which I think is in continuity with the kind of perspective that Susan was articulating about her work on Jane Addams. She had intended, I think, between some of the earlier work, there was a book that never quite got written on political mothers, that she had gotten interested in Middle Eastern mothers of the disappeared in South America. And that kind of work was always in the service of people like a Jane Addams or a Dietrich Bonhoeffer who had been willing to bear a witness, often in the midst of suffering and conflict, that was really transformational. And she was always taken with those kinds of people who probed deeply and would, in the face of great difficulty, nonetheless hold up an inspiring vision of what human life can be and should be, of what human flourishing involves. I discovered, you know, in the early days of my friendship with Jean, she was featured along with several of her colleagues and friends in an article in the New Oxford Review. I don't even remember who wrote it, but it was scholars who defy categorization as conservative or liberal. And as I was looking at the list, I thought to myself, well, these are the people I like to read. It was Jean, it was Christopher Lash, there were a whole collection of them, Elizabeth Fox Genovese and her husband Eugene. These were people who always made you think differently. And one of the things that I always just admired about Jean was that whenever I was with her or whenever we were on the phone with each other, interacting in whatever context, I always wanted to ask her what she was reading. Because she read so widely, so deeply, so richly that it was almost always something that I immediately wanted to get my hands on. Fiction, nonfiction, technical scholarly work on Augustine, all kinds of things. She was a little crazy on her musical preferences, but reading she was really sophisticated and savvy. Byron mentioned that we laughed a lot. There were lots of just funny stories, largely born out of the encounters that Jean would have in the academy. In many ways, she started out so constructively, and she ended constructively, but she kept getting boxed in by the narrowness of disciplines and departments and the increasingly tribal tendencies of the academy. A more generous intellectual figure it would be hard to know or imagine than Jane Addams. She would engage anybody, anytime, anywhere. It put her in odd company. And sometimes I say, gee, why are you going to talk to them? She'd say, they asked. And I would think, yikes, I don't have nearly the courage you have. But I tried to learn from it. There was a, I will take the risk of telling a funny story that's a little bit odd, just because it was an example of how Jean was invariably charitable when she was in public and would interpret everybody in the best possible light. But if you got her after dinner, particularly with a glass of, well, shall we say, Dr. Pepper, she would sometimes let loose. And one day she told me a story about when she'd been at a conference at the University of Wisconsin. And it was a conference on feminist thought across the disciplines. This was before she was declared kind of persona non grata in women's studies areas, because she like read her critics and did really radical things. But she was there, and Mary Daly, the radical feminist theologian at Boston College for many years, was also there. And some of you may know Mary Daly didn't allow men to speak in her classes. She didn't even want men to take her classes. She didn't want men to touch anything that she might touch. It was really kind of bizarre. And she was quite radical in almost every respect. She was also fairly self-absorbed, so she didn't pay much attention. And Jean said, you know, when you're flying from Madison to Chicago, you're going to be all on the same little puddle jumper, kind of like Waco to Dallas. And so after the conference, she got on the plane. She was sitting down. She figured Mary Daly hadn't even quite registered who Jean was, because she just wasn't interested in other people. And Jean cringed when she found out that Mary was on the other side of the aisle directly across from her. She thought, oh my goodness, please don't talk to me. And so she was trying to read and ignore it. Whereupon the flight attendant came down to offer Mary Daly something to drink. She asked for a glass of water. Flight attendant started to put ice into the cup, and Mary Daly freaked. And she said, no ice, no ice. And she just started screaming, no ice. And the flight attendant was really taken aback. And so she dumped out the ice and just poured the water at room temperature and gave it to Mary Daly. And flight attendant went on a little farther back, and Mary Daly then turned to Jean and said, you know what's in ice? And Jean just said, no. Mary Daly said, gang rape. Whereupon Jean just kind of didn't know what to say, and so she just said, you mean even in the ice cubes I make at home? That was the kind of spirit that, even in the midst of sheer absurdity, Jean found a way to turn the conversation into a constructive space, or at least a humorous one. Her infectious love of life, of conversation, her sense of humor was quite extraordinary throughout life. I've never met anybody with more energy and more perseverance. I once was with her. I had invited her to speak at a conference in Sea Island, Georgia, and offered to help carry some of her stuff, and she got mad at me for doing so. And she said, I'm fine. And I said, you know, you're saying yes to too many people late at night and too many people early in the morning. You know, you need some rest. And then she said to me, she said, when you've had polio as a child, I just decided I was never going to stop or let anything get me down. And that kind of courage and that kind of perseverance was extraordinary. She was an incredible woman. And when Byron just mentioned it and mentioned the connection to the broader Elshtain family, it was a great delight and honor to be able to participate. I'll just leave you with this. In my view, Jean Addams is one of the most singular people in life that I've ever known, who was a gracious visionary and a persistent critic, always in the service of the deepest of humanity, the best of wisdom, and the most broad sense of community. It was a privilege to know her.
Well, I hate to do this to our last two speakers, because Greg's always a tough act to follow, but I'm going to ask Darren Davis to come. Darren and David Corey are going to offer comments. They both had a chance to interact with Jean during her 2 years here. Others did too, of course. The Nichols back here in Clinton. David Clinton from Political Science, but I'm going to ask Darren Davis to come up and share a few of his interactions with Jane Addams.
Well, I'm really honored to be able to speak a little bit about learning from Jane Addams and being in her company on a few occasions. I'm going to begin by reading a list of names and ask you to think about what they share in common. Robert Putnam, the author of Bowling Alone, Gil Mylander, the eminent Christian ethicist, James Davison Hunter, Paul Griffiths, Candace Vogler, Margaret Somerville, the great Canadian intellectual, John Haldane, Robert Solomon, the esteemed late philosopher at the University of Texas, David Solomon from Notre Dame, the Jesuit astronomer Guy Consolmagno, the director Bruce Beresford, award-winning director of Tender Mercies, and even Greg Jones. And I'll add one other name, Jane Addams. What these people have in common is they've all traveled in a car that I drove. In 2009, I made an invitation to Jane to come to Baylor to be a plenary speaker of a major conference on secularization that I partnered with Tommy Kidd and Byron in planning. And so I made arrangements with her and had warm email correspondence, and I went to Dallas to pick her up and bring her back to Waco. And we had an extraordinary visit on that 2-plus-hour drive because of the traffic. We talked about philosophy and theology, my own interest in moral philosophy, but we also talked a good bit about the importance of family, her family, who she dearly loved. She was as deeply interested in my own family as I was in hers. And Jane had a real interest in abiding love in place, namely the place where she was from. And so I think driving back through Texas, and I began to talk a little bit about my own upbringing in the Texas Panhandle and hers in northern Colorado. We began to talk about places that were established by people who were tied to the land, to farmers, to ranchers, to cows, and to horses. And I think that particularity to place was very important to her, although she made her life and her work across the country. We shared an affinity on that. I must say, too, as we drove, I was trying to be as hospitable as I could and knew that it had gotten late in the day. Wanted to make sure I was taking good care of her. And I said, "Are you hungry?" And she said, "Yes, I really am." I said, "Well, Waco's not far." She said, "Well, I'm really hungry now." I said, "Well, what sounds good to you?" She said, "How about a cheeseburger?" I said, "You're in luck." Because in the town of Hillsboro, Texas, there is the southernmost Brahms restaurant where you can get a really good cheeseburger, and she was most interested in getting a chocolate shake. So we stopped and went through the drive-thru, and I can say without exception, no one has enjoyed a cheeseburger and a chocolate shake more in a car that I have driven than Jane Addams. And there's been some competition. Authenticity. One of the things that you know from watching her speak, watching her teach, and reading the things that she wrote was that she knew who she was. And it seems to me, in hearing from her friends and from her family and reflecting upon some things that she wrote that have been important to me, that she never forgot who she was. And that indeed she became what we all hope for, which is a better version of ourselves. Jean's talk that she gave was titled Genetic Fundamentalism and the Myth of the Sovereign Self. And after that lecture, she took questions from Baylor undergraduates. It was the only time that I remember in all the conferences that I have been a part of that all the questions came from undergraduates. She so engaged our students. And that talk in which she asked this important question about the way in which the assumption of the sovereign self had undermined the notion of the human person resonated incredibly with our students for months and even years to come. She was a teacher to them. There was in her lecture a charitable spirit, an intellectually charitable spirit, and an abiding concern for the common good. And I think students were drawn to that, and I know those who heard the talk were drawn to that because we live in a world that seems very fragmented, and we also live in a world that seems at times very cynical about anything having to do with the common good. And she held those two things together. And finally, there is a wonderful essay that Jean wrote for a volume edited by my colleagues here, Doug Henry and Mike Beatty. The book is called Christianity and the Soul of the University. And she wrote an essay titled To Serve God Wittily in the Tangle of One's Mind. And there is a particular passage in that essay that I have found inspiring to offer up to young Christian scholars. She recounts the time in which she challenged a colleague in economics about his assumptions about what economics was about. Maybe it wasn't about, insofar as presumptions lead the way, about scarcity and about the utilitarian calculus. Maybe the guiding presumptions of economics, God's economy, have to do with the human person. Well, she got, of course, a strong counter-argument from the economist, and it led her to realize some things. And this is what she writes. Do not be afraid. We are so easily embarrassed or can be made to feel embarrassed for sustaining the centuries-long effort of thoughtful Christians to bring together faith, scholarship, and the life of the mind. We worry that people will think that we are wearing our faith on our sleeves, and that even the dynamic process of bringing concepts and categories to bear on a range of contemporary issues constitutes an example of such. We suppose others will imagine that we are not thinking at all, and that we want them to condone or to embrace our presumably uncritical perspective. And then she writes, "If I have learned anything in my own pilgrimage, it is to put such fears, embarrassment, worries, and suppositions aside. Do not be afraid." She was a woman of incredible physical courage. She was a woman of incredible intellectual courage. Family, I want you to know in particular how much those of us who came to know her at Baylor are grateful to you for sharing your wife and your mom and your grandmother with us. The last email that Jean and I shared, the first line in which she wrote, "Dear Darren, I hope our paths cross again soon." And I think that's the hope that we all have. And I hope, and I know, that we will. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Darren. Well, David Corey, political scientist, had a number of occasions to even have Jean in his home for dinner with students and other colleagues, and became another close ally of Jean's. So David, come share some comments with us, please.
I thought it would be fun just to show the family how Jean intersected with yet another person. She intersected with so many people and had such a positive impact on so many people. When I was a graduate student in political science, the name Jane Addams was put forward to me by one of my mentors as a special kind of exemplar. What made her special within the discipline, I was told, was not only that she was a brilliant political theorist, which she was, but also someone who could make political theory speak to our present political times and to readers who were not specialists, those two qualities. My mentor likened Jean to his favorite political theorist, not mine, Karl Marx, whom he loved and admired very deeply. But he likened her also to Hannah Arendt, whom he and I both loved very deeply, as did Jean herself, I would later come to learn. Graduate education in political theory was, for me at least, a long and patient apprenticeship to the canonical greats in the genre. We started with Plato, we ended with Nietzsche, covering major writers in between, such as Aristotle, Augustine, Aquinas, Machiavelli, Hobbes, Locke, Rousseau, and Kant, to name just a few. In those years, I didn't have time to read Jane Addams, though the desire was certainly there. But I remember in 2002, when I arrived at my first professional post, where I still am today, I was slated to teach a course in American political thought, and I knew I wanted to begin to do something like what my mentor had found so admirable in Jane Addams. I wanted to speak to contemporary issues in a way that was not overly laden with jargon. So I went to the bookstore and I bought a copy of Jean's book, Democracy on Trial, and began what would be a long engagement with Jean's work, resulting eventually in an all too brief friendship. There was something else my mentor said about Jean. He said she was in some important respects a phenomenologist, someone who begins from life's real loves and fears, and especially life's real attachments to such things as family. I discovered the truth of this from the moment I picked up her book, Democracy on Trial. She writes in the preface, "As I write this preface on a sparkling, windy spring day in Cambridge, Massachusetts, where I am spending a semester at Harvard, I have some preliminary thoughts. The first is that having just become a grandmother, the year was 1994, I am touched and elated and saddened. This glorious mark of the passage of time reminds us of our own mortality. We are being told that one day we must get out of the way to make room for newcomers. And that is as it should be. My sadness does not flow from that recognition. Rather, it wells up as I reflect on the kind of America my granddaughter will grow up in. Because she has wonderful parents and a big supportive family, she has the best of all possible head starts, but that will not suffice. If she is to take her place as a proud citizen one day, there must be a culture worthy of endorsement and engagement. I'm not convinced that this is the America she will discover a mere 15 or 20 years from now." Here exactly is what my mentor was talking about. Jean's political theorizing emerged from profound personal experience. Love of family, fear for her granddaughter's future, anxiety over the decline of a country she loved. Jean's incisive insight into that decline, the political decline, the cultural decline, is worth celebrating, even though the topic is a sad one, because she threw such a bright beam of light for us, not only in telling us where we'd gone wrong, but also in showing us a way forward. Listen to how enduring her basic criticism of the 1990s America remains to this day. I mean, this could have been written yesterday. "The language of opposition now appears as a cascading series of manifestos that tell us we cannot live together. We cannot work together. We are not in this together. We are not Americans who have something in common. but racial, ethnic, gender, or sexual identities, clans, who demand to be recognized only or exclusively as different. Think about, this is Gene Still, think about how odd this is on the face of it. I require you recognize that we have nothing in common with one another. This demand is rapidly becoming a shared civic zaniness that threatens to implode our culture. We are in danger of losing democratic civil society, she wrote in 1994. Jean worried that there was no escape from a culture that turns against itself like this. Surely she's right. She saw and wrote that resentment breeds resentment. Hatred fuels hatred. Isolation feeds paranoia. Cynicism stokes mistrust, and fear generates flight from neighborliness. Neighborliness has been a theme through everybody's paper here. Jean worried that there was no escape from this culture. In 2002, I taught and learned from Democracy on Trial. But we were at that time on the brink of war with Iraq. And just as I had learned from Jean's example that we must speak to our present situation, I decided I needed to turn my attention not to domestic politics so much as to the ethics of war. I began a decade-long study of what we call the just war tradition. When I began my study of the just war tradition, I didn't even know such a tradition existed. I was basically trying to cobble together the reflections on war that I'd learned from the canonical writers of political philosophy. I desperately needed a guide. Some of you will know where this is going. Imagine my surprise and deep-felt sense of relief when in 2003 there should appear, hot off the press, a new book by Jane Addams called Just War Against Terror. I devoured that book, learning not only from its content, but also from its feisty refusal to accept half-truths, an ideological claptrap, instead of clear, existentially grounded use of language. Here's Elshtain again, writing in that book. Draining words of meaning is a mark of what Vaclav Havel calls pseudo-ideological thinking, which separates the words we use from the realities they purport to describe. What Havel calls evasive language has separated thought from its immediate contact with reality and crippled its capacity to intervene in that reality effectively. In a situation in which non-combatants are deliberately targeted and the murder of the maximum number of non-combatants is the explicit aim, using terms like fighter or soldier or noble warrior is not only beside the point, it is pernicious. Jean was quickly becoming more than an exemplar for me. She was becoming a hero. I remember sitting on my living room sofa one evening with a close friend of mine, another political theorist my age, looking at Jean's CV, which I'd printed out to see what else of hers I could read. As anyone who has done this knows, it's a humbling experience. How do you wrap your mind around someone who's written or edited more than 20 books and published over 500 essays? We couldn't get through her CV, much less her corpus. This was not just humbling, it was positively deflating. Truth be told, I had since graduate school harbored tacitly, I never said it, but maybe a small fantasy that maybe one day I could be like Jean Addams. What a naive mistake. Now there was no question. I could perhaps be like Jean Addams in one attribute or another, but nobody could be like Jean Addams. She was a force of nature, indefatigable, unsurpassable, inimitable. So that's just something I had to come to terms with. And I'm glad I did, because it prepared me to become her friend. I cannot believe Baylor's good fortune in having Jean Addams join us as a colleague for however short a time. We were so honored to have her, and she worked hard for us and for our students. The culmination of my own reflections on the just war tradition resulted in a book with the title The Just War Tradition. I didn't have the knack for titles. Jean had a knack for titles. Mine were just sort of fell dead born, stillborn, you know. And Jean was kind enough to read the manuscript and blurb the book before it went to press. I'm really proud to see and touched that when the library arrived, she had two copies of my book that were there. She once told me just before she passed away that she intended to use my book with her students at Chicago, since it had an effective way of presenting a deep reading of canonical writers on war so as to bring out their insights vividly. I cherished and still cherish that comment. Though I have to say my work is very modest compared to Jean's seminal work in recovering the just war tradition, and I could not have even imagined my work without looking to hers as a guide. I think Jean herself understood something of what it's like to feel humility in the face of greatness, as I did with her. She expressed this in her published Gifford lectures titled Sovereignty, God, State, and Self, and I will close with this. She writes, and this is her last book, I believe. I don't think she wrote another book after that. I'm almost certain that that's the last book. As I grow older, and hopefully a bit wiser, I am ever mindful that St. Bernard of Clairvaux's observation that we stand on the shoulders of giants is a truth that engenders humility and an appropriate awareness of the finiteness of our own enterprises. We are all laborers in the vineyard, and if we are lucky, we add just a bit to the storehouse of wisdom and knowledge that is our shared human inheritance. One of my persistent worries about our own time is that we may be squandering a good bit of that rich heritage through processes of organized forgetting, a climate of opinion that encourages presentism rather than a historic perspective that reminds us that we are always boats moving against the current, borne back ceaselessly into the past, as F. Scott Fitzgerald remarked in his memorable words from The Great Gatsby. This historic recognition should not occasion resentment, she writes, or dour heaviness. Rather, it should instill gratitude. As this book drew to a close, she writes, I realized that it was not culminating in a magnum opus, few books are, but rather a contribution to the shared memory of our time and place. And that is enough, she writes. We at Baylor, and I know I can speak for my colleagues here, I know I can, are also moved to greatness, to gratefulness, I mean to say, by Jean, on whose shoulders we stand. And we are especially grateful that she contributed to our shared memory of our time and place. And that is enough. Thank you.
Thank you, David. Well, we have a few more minutes, and I was wondering if I might get Eric and Earl to share a few comments, because we have until 11:30. Mm-hmm. So it's okay if we let people go a little early, but if you'd like to say something, the floor is yours. Eric?
It's always so wonderful to hear the lives that our mother has touched throughout the years. We just knew her as Mom mostly, so it's always extraordinary to come to events during her life and after her death to hear how many people she moved intellectually and emotionally. And as Professor Johnson mentioned, shortly after her death, we got in touch. I'd mentioned this collection of books. And when he told us that Baylor and the new ISR Philosophical and Theological Library would love to house my mother's book collection, I'm not sure he knew exactly what he was getting into. But we cannot be any more pleased for these volumes to find their home here at Baylor, where my mother very much enjoyed her time speaking and teaching. And though that time here was relatively short, she spoke of Baylor in a way that made it clear to us that you held a special place in her heart and mind. As I was going through and packing up what turned out to be close to 3 tons worth of books and commitment on your part, I found many of the books filled, of course, with marginalia, markings, notes of some sort, records of my mother's voice and interests, and often disagreements with the authors. I grew concerned, especially with the volumes whose bindings were split apart with use, held together with ever-aging rubber bands, and that these markings and writings and ad hoc bindings would not suit a library. When I asked about these books, Professor Johnson replied, "The markings make the books even more significant to us." And so if we had not felt so already at that moment, we knew the books had found their proper home. These books are in many ways a measure not only of my mother's intellectual interests, but also of her moral life, steeped as she was in thinkers mentioned here like Augustine, Camus, Bonhoeffer, and Arendt. And to put it in another more highfalutin way, these are not just artifacts of her epistemology, but evidence of her ontology as well. So much so that as I went through the books, I could hear her voice ring through her jottings and notes, rigorously questioning, addressing, assenting, and debating with the authors, as if I were listening in on a conversation between deep intellectual friends. And so we are humbled and honored that Baylor is the home for the books that were such a vital aspect of my mother's life and world. And we know that she is well pleased that she can, through these volumes, continue to spur conversations and intense, respectful debates, those debates she felt were being lost in our society, even in 1994, as mentioned, that she could continue to spur those sorts of conversations and respectful debates among students and professors. Thank you so much. And thank you for all of your kind remarks. I appreciate it very much, and as we all do.
You want to leave it at that, Earl? Or do you want to
say? I'll just say one little thing. One of the things Jean, she didn't ask me a lot of questions because I couldn't answer them, but one of the things she often said to me was, did I always think this? And truth be told, looking at some of the early things she wrote about in her journals, obviously her thought evolved tremendously over time, but the core things of interest to her, which were alluded to by all of the speakers today, were really there from the beginning. That that growing up in that little town in Colorado, and she realized what that meant. She obviously lived in a much larger society than that little town of 200 folks. But that's where some of her basic ideas and concepts and things that she would think about were forged. And so I said, as far as I know, you always thought that. So even though she was able to couch it in different ways and more intellectually, but those core things were always there. We had her memorial service in Fort Collins. She's buried not far from her parents in Fort Collins. And a gentleman who had been in grade school with her was in attendance. He was just delightful. He's gone to school with her in Tinnap, which is a little town, and then they had moved to La Porte, a little bit bigger city just outside of Fort Collins. And he said that after she was no longer in class, there would be a question, and no one knew the answer, but they would all say, "Well, Jean were here, she would." I greatly appreciate the comments the folks made. It was her feelings for you were reciprocated. She really enjoyed being at Baylor. She found it very congenial. She thought the students were
were great, and so thanks very much. And we're really so happy that her collection is here. So thank you.
Thank you.
Well, I really can't offer much more than what you've heard today from our great speakers. Susan, thank you for that wonderful paper. And Greg, thank you for those great comments. Greg Jones is, in addition to being a brilliant scholar, is one of the funniest people on the planet. And he had us in stitches last night. You can ask the family if you want to afterward. And Darren, thank you. And David, thank you for those wonderful remarks. And again, we thank the family for making this trek all the way to Waco. They flew into Dallas, and they have a huge van that they're all traveling together in. So it wasn't any problem picking them out last night. I just saw that big van, and I thought, that's got to be the Elshtains. So anyways, thank you all for coming.